Millsaps, welcome to prospective students. I know we have some prospective students here. Welcome to alums who've come back to campus. And welcome to all of you. This is a real treat for us all. So without anything further from me, I'm going to hand it on over to Shadow. Shadow.
So before... So I had one brief thing I wanted to say about the nature of science before I introduce our speaker, and that science is really, really hard. So welcome all of you, and I can't describe how much of an honor it is for me to spend so much time with Alex and get to introduce him today. The list that I wrote is 2 pages long, and I finally summarized it. He is the Richard and Rhoda Goldman Distinguished Professor at Cal Berkeley. He is one of the most highly cited astronomers, astrophysicists in the world. If you have ever seen anyone talk about a black hole on television, they're probably talking to Alex, or talking about Alex, or Alex is about to join the screen. And the thing that matters most to me, the thing that really resonates with me, is he's also been nominated and won National Professor of the Year in 2006. That's for the whole country. He's been voted by the students 9 times the best professor at Cal Berkeley. And the thing that really resonates deeply with me is he gets it. When I say science is hard, all of us, I still think of it as the technical skills, that it's hard to figure out how to mix these chemicals. It's hard to figure out how to do these math problems. It's hard to figure out, you know, what's not working with my code. But where it really gets hard is when we run into things that are new to us, that are different than anything we expected, and we are asked to change our understanding of the universe. In the late 90s, as a graduate student, I had a moment where someone ran in and said, "You gotta hear this." They told me something, and I said literally, "This isn't the universe I signed up for. I'll be back on Monday." And I left, because it was so different than the universe I had expected, wanted, and thought should be. But that's not how science works. Science leads us on this amazing journey if we're willing to be open to it. And he knows what the discovery was, because it's his. And so I can't wait to see what journey Alex will take us on. So please welcome Alex Filippenko.
Well, thank you very much, Shadow, for that very warm introduction. And it's great to be here at Millsaps. I've had a wonderful visit so far. I arrived yesterday, and we had a delightful dinner at the president's house. And that was really fantastic. Thank you for that. And then I was at St. Joseph Catholic School this morning, where I met with the student body and spoke to them. And we blessed a telescope, not the James Observatory, which is on your campus here, but the Hewlett Observatory at St. Joseph School. So that's been really a lot of fun. And I want to tell you today about this expanding universe in which we live, and a little bit about total solar eclipses, because there's an opportunity coming to you soon. So I will stop, or I start with that topic. Total solar eclipses occur when the moon covers the face of the sun, all right? It doesn't happen very often, about once every year and a half somewhere on Earth, but the area in which the eclipse occurs is only about 0.5% of Earth's surface, okay? So if you don't go to see, you know, on your own, a total solar eclipse, one will come and visit you roughly every 400 years, okay? So that's the, those are the odds, all right? After 5,000 years, I think you have a 99%+ chance of seeing one, but I don't know, a few of us will live to the, you know, to be 5,000 years old. So you have to go and see it, all right? Now, normally you don't want to look at the sun because it's too bright. It'll burn your eyes, all right? But the eclipse occurs when the moon casts a shadow on Earth. And in fact, I have a little pointer. I forgot to bring it out there. I guess I could just use my pointer here. But you've got this shadow that doesn't work. Oh, well. Falling on a very, very small part of Earth, okay? So that's when the sun gets covered, revealing this high temperature but very low density and very faint corona. You can't see it normally because sunlight is scattered off of Earth's atmosphere, making the sky bright and blue, and you can't just hold up your fist or a tennis ball and block out the sun because the scattering has already occurred in Earth's atmosphere. Earth's sky is already bright. So you need to block the sunlight before it reaches Earth's atmosphere, and that's what the sun, that's what the moon does. So it reveals this corona and a diamond ring just before the last little bit of the sun gets covered up. And I know that the pictures only reveal a tiny bit about the phenomenon. Even videos don't really do it justice, which reminds me, I forgot to plug this in. Here it is. I believe this is the audio cable, right? This is an audio cable. Will it reach the computer? Yeah, I forgot to test this. Is that the audio cable? Now, here's the audio cable. This guy, right? That's an audio cable? Good. All right. Well, it made a sound just now. I don't know if it's the right sound. But anyway, the video will convey a little bit more of what I'm talking about, but you really have to be there to experience this. So the partial phases spend, you know, about an hour plus leading up to totality, and this is what you see. And then when that last little tiny bit of sunlight is showing, in a photograph like this one, that little bit of the sun's disk is overexposed. So it makes a jewel, like a diamond here, and yet the inner part of the corona and a colorful thin layer called the chromosphere begin to appear. And so you see a ring like this, and this is called the diamond ring of the progression. You know, you get two diamond rings, one at the very beginning and one at the very end. And this is a magical moment because the sky is darkening very quickly and many changes are occurring. By the way, have any of you been to a total solar eclipse? Partial doesn't count. Anyone here? Am I exaggerating? No? You too will be a lunatic. Your life will have been changed. You know, once you see one, lunatic, that's a bit of a pun. Yeah. But anyway, it's really a very moving experience, and it's beyond description, okay? So you just have to experience it yourself. Anyway, then that last tiny bit of the sun gets covered, and you get this thin layer called the chromosphere. It's only about 10,000 kilometers thick or so, but it glows with this pinkish color because it's hydrogen gas that's pretty hot, and it's been excited in such a way that there are electrons in the third energy level and they're hopping down to the second energy level, and that produces a deep red line. But there are some other transitions of hydrogen and helium as well, and all together they produce this pinkish glow. Chromo, color, sphere, circle, sphere, so there it is, you can see it. In a deeper picture, you can see the corona. The great thing about your eyes is that they have a tremendous dynamic range. Your eyes can see bright things and faint things simultaneously. No single photograph can do that, although now professional photographers combine many different CCD exposures or CMOS, like digital camera exposures, to try to reproduce what your eye sees. But what your eye sees is better than this. And it's the changing temperatures and the changing light and all the reactions of the people. Like I said, I know I sound a bit like a nut. You might wonder, why did Millsaps College, invite this bozo from Berserkly, after all, to come here and tell you about this? He sounds like a blithering idiot. Maybe he even is. But I'm telling you, most, not all, but most people are transformed in some visceral way after having experienced a total solar eclipse. Now, what the heck happened just now? That's very weird. Did you see that? Was it just my eyes, or did the image go away? Anyway, I don't know. All right, but it came back, so. All right, well, then at the very end, you get your second diamond ring. In fact, I proposed to my wife at a solar eclipse trip, not during totality, because she probably would have beat me over the head had I done that, but it was at a cruise for a total solar eclipse in 2005. And I gave her not one diamond ring, but two, you see. So, which really means I gave her zero diamond rings, but whatever. Anyway, so here's a video which does a bit better in trying to convey the excitement people feel. This is, all right, we need, the sound, more sound. Let's turn it up. No? Okay. Well, let's just be super quiet. And can you hear it? If everyone is really... Okay, let's try it again. There's totality, okay? that screaming was before totality. People are not being paid to do this. I didn't even know that they knew that that recording was being made. All right, so then we fast forward. It lasted a couple of minutes, but let me show you the end. A couple of minutes later, this cloud parked itself in front of the sun for the next 10 minutes. We were really lucky. It's magnificent. What can I say? It's just a magnificent experience, all right? And having some clouds heightens the sensations because you know, you're not sure if a cloud will cover you. Anyway, it's really fantastic. So the moon orbits Earth, okay? And so this little tiny place where a shadow has been cast moves across Earth's curved surface, all right? And here from a satellite, do we hear something in the background? No. I thought maybe it was a CNN report. I was looking at the news this morning, and you know, sometimes these programs reboot themselves. Anyway, here's a few images from a NASA satellite taken maybe half an hour, 45 minute intervals, something like that. And you can see the shadow that the moon has cast upon Earth, moving at 1,000 to 2,000 miles an hour across Earth's surface, intersecting the tip of Baja California here, and then it went right over Mexico City and over the Caribbean and stuff. But that was the path near Mexico, and you see most of the U.S., all of the U.S. had some degree of partial eclipse. In Maine, maybe not, but down here in Texas quite a bit, in Mississippi, definitely a nice partial eclipse. But you have to be in this path of totality, okay? Because if you're even here, if you're at the 95% mark, you know, I've talked to people who have said, oh, I haven't been to a total eclipse, but I've been to a 95% eclipsed sun. And I'm all like, well, you know, have you been pregnant or not pregnant, okay? I mean, there's a big difference, all right? Can't be almost pregnant. I mean, you either are or you are not, and so it's really that much of a difference, right? It's trite, but it's more than just the difference between night and day, okay? Because there's so many other phenomena. You know, you see this amazing corona and stuff, and the structure there is caused by the corona's very hot particles, charged particles at millions of degrees, actually, being hooked onto the sun's magnetic field. And the magnetic field of the sun changes with time. And so the structure of the corona changes. That's from the eclipse of 2006 over Libya. So here's a bunch of these paths. We're in 2017 now, in this quarter century. So you can see all the total eclipses of this current quarter century, all right? You can see there's not that many of them. And in most parts of the world, you will not be within the moon's shadow. But if you look carefully, there's that path there, and the date is 2017, August 21st, crossing from coast to coast the United States for the first time in a century, and hitting any part of the continental United States for the first time in 38 years. The previous occurrence was February 26th, 1979, when it went coincidentally through Oregon and then up into Canada. That was my first, actually, the one on February 26th, 1979. So we in the U.S. have been waiting a long time for this, and moreover, it is an all-American eclipse, because you see, it does not hit any land anywhere else. All right? Okay. Here's a projection of what's going on. These gray areas here are where you will see a partial eclipse. The black dot is where you really want to be if you're able to go. And everyone in the continental US will be within about 1,000 or at most 1,500 miles from somewhere along the path of totality. So unless you've got a really good excuse, there's no reason not to travel to see it, okay? I tell my own students that if I find out that they were working in a city that's 100 miles from the path of totality and they did not go and see the total eclipse, I will retroactively fail them and their entire careers will have been blown to smithereens, okay? So you gotta be within that path. Now, if you can't, then at least enjoy the partial eclipse, but it's not the same thing, but at least do that. I mean, I understand. Not all 300 million people will be along that path of totality. The country still has to keep running and stuff. Anyway, across the US, here it is, and you can easily find this. There's tons of websites. Just use your favorite search engine. Total solar eclipse, August 2017, path. All right, you can even click on Google, I'm feeling lucky, which is the top, you know, hit, and it'll land you on one of these things. The longest duration will be right here in your neck of the woods. It'll be shorter where I plan to be and a little bit shorter here, but this is the maximum, 2 minutes and 44 seconds. You snooze, you lose. Go to the bathroom well before totality, okay? The excitement will grow, so even if you think you don't need to go to the bathroom, you will as totality gets closer, okay? So go, know, and go before you have to go. So anyway, here you are in Jackson, all right? So you're reasonably close, right? Here's a closer close-up of it. There you are, and somewhere there is where you want to be, okay? Somewhere along this path. Doesn't have to be right on the blue thing. That's the center line. That's where the duration is the longest. But the length of totality is a very slow function of distance from the center line until you get close to the edge, at which point the duration plummets. But if you're 10 or 20 miles from the center line, that's okay. Just don't be 40 or 50 miles from the center line, okay? So you need to be somewhere along there. And I checked this on Google Maps. You know, you go up 55, you know, you can get up into this region in about 7 hours. I'm told Memphis is 3 hours away, okay, right? So you can be up here in 7 hours, or you can go along the 20 and then to the 59 through Chattanooga and end up somewhere here. You know, that would be a fine place to be right there, okay? And it'll be an afternoon for you guys here. It'll be at 10:20 in the morning in Oregon where I'll be. But then the shadow has to race along the US at 1,000 miles an hour, so that's a bit later in time by the time it gets to you, plus there's two time zones. So it's sometime around 2 in the afternoon for you, but you can look all this stuff up, all right? Get there early. Mark my words, there's gonna be a lot of buildup in the months, weeks, and especially days before this eclipse. There's going to be a lot of buildup. There's going to be millions of people going along those roads. You know, it's a 7-hour journey if you drive. You might fly, whatever. But if it's a 7-hour journey and the eclipse is, say, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, don't leave at 9 in the morning that morning, okay? Leave at 3 in the morning or something like that. Or come the night before, spend the night in a hotel. You won't find a hotel at this point on the path of totality. They have been booked up for more than a year. I kid you not. So you book a hotel somewhere in, you know, Chattanooga or something like that, and then drive the rest of the way the next day, all right? And if you're in that path, you'll get the whole thing. You won't necessarily get that creature that's taken in Malaysia at the last eclipse that I attended March 9th of last year. But you'll get something like this, you'll get the whole thing. But if you're stuck in Jackson, I'm not saying it's a bad place to be stuck generally, but, you know, if you really cannot get away, then all you'll have are the partial phases instead of partial plus total. And I understand, sometimes things get in the way, but, you know, if your daughter or son or whatever wants to get married in Jackson that day, you say, no, I'm not going to pay for it. You're getting married the next day or something like that. Or maybe you can get married but along the path of totality, but then get good luck getting hotel reservations for your guests. So you just be firm. No other plans for August 21st, 2017. You got that? I'm going to ask my friend Pat, who organized this trip, how many of you went? And if it's not many, I will say tisk tisk, okay? Anyway, so those are the partial phases. Here they are sped up considerably. It takes a couple of hours to go through all that. To view the partial phases safely, you look through a thing called shade 14 welder's glass. This is too dark even for most commercial welding applications, but welding supply stores will make stuff that's this dark. I can't see those lights, you know, maybe a little tiny bit. This will give a green color to the sun, and you can mount it on cardboard. Here my brother and I are in Mongolia in 2008. Great excuse to travel and see the world, by the way. Go to all these exotic places. Places you would have wanted to have seen anyway. Indonesia, Mongolia, Thailand, whatever. Anyway, this is really easy. They're durable. I actually stick them in my pockets when I'm in a line somewhere. I'll whip one out, look at the sun, look for sunspots. People look at me like I'm weird or something. But, you know, whatever. I've grown up with that, so no big deal. There I am off the coast of Morocco in the Cape Verde Islands in October of 2013. And that was actually my 13th total solar eclipse. The number is now up to 15, because there was one in 2016 and one in 2017. You can attach this to FedEx boxes or whatever and shield yourself. This provides good shielding because, you know, if you're looking at the sun over the partial phases for a couple of hours, you want to, you know, protect the rest of your skin. And you can even stick it on a box and put the whole box over your head. You know, you can be creative. Anyway, I've got a bunch of these if you want. I brought them. They're $2 a piece. That's the cost, you know, if you want. I have a bunch of them. Or you can get a cheaper variety for about $1 in bulk online. These are proper filters that are mounted in cardboard. And so if you stuff it in your pocket, it might get crinkled. It might not last a long time. But if you order it now and you just use it for the eclipse, it's fine. You can get a package of 25 of them for about $25. There are other ones as well, besides this Rainbow company or whatever that sells this. But if you get them online, be sure you get the CE certified kind. That cuts out 99.999% of the visible light. It's got to be 5 nines. Fewer nines is not good. You could harm your eyes. 100% would not be good because you wouldn't see anything. Okay? Does cut out 100% of the harmful ultraviolet and infrared. Okay, so get the kinds that are certified. Here's a woman in November of 94 in Peru enjoying the eclipse and perhaps something else. I don't know. We slept on those rocks, okay, because it was a morning eclipse and it was off in the Peruvian Andes, and we were afraid that if we drive up the morning of the eclipse, the local officials, seeing an astonishing fundraising opportunity, could block the road and simply demand $50,000, right? What's to stop them? People have traveled thousands of miles to get there, right? Some of these people are really quite well off. Maybe they would have paid it. So we said, all right, we're actually going to go the night before and roll out our sleeping bags on these rocks. You clear the rocks away. And so that's what we did. Wasn't the most restful night, but we got to see the eclipse, so. Or you can make a pinhole camera. No glass, no plastic needed. It turns out you take a piece of cardboard, punch a hole that's roughly the size of a pencil, easy to do. That forms a little camera, because if you have a luminous object, light rays will go through that hole and form an inverted image. All right, so that's a good way to look at the partial phases. By the way, during totality, filters off, and don't be using one of these pinhole cameras either. You want to be looking at the eclipse. Totally safe during the total eclipse. Not safe without a filter or a pinhole camera during any of the partial phases. The one exception I make is the couple of seconds of the diamond ring effect I look at with my naked eye. Not through binoculars or a telescope, because that could collect so much light that it would burn the retina. But I claim a few seconds naked eye is okay for the diamond ring, and that to me is really the most exciting part of the eclipse. It's just a magical moment. And then totality, naked eye, binoculars, telescope, naked eye is just fine. But anyway, here I am, you know, with one of these pinhole cameras where I made a bunch of holes in honor of my older son, Simon, my oldest son. And of course, you can't view an eclipse without using appropriate celestially themed candy like eclipse gum and orbit gum. And I do not own stock in any of these companies, okay? But anyway, there it is. It adds to the whole experience. And there is my son's name, Simon, and you can see a bunch of these little partial eclipses. It's just really fun. You can even, you know, put your hands together like this. That forms little pinhole cameras, or you can use a colander. Or in Mexico in 91, I was walking along, taking a bathroom break during the partial phases, and I looked at the bricks below some trees, and all these little crescent suns were underneath me because the spaces between the leaves formed little pinhole cameras. They don't have to be round spaces. You get an image of the sun, and when the sun is crescent-shaped, you get a bunch of crescent suns underneath the tree. It's just magical. I forgot to load that in. Anyway, hopefully you'll go to where it is total, and you'll enjoy both the partial phases and the really stunning part, totality. But even if you can't go there, well, enjoy it one way or another. But try to go somewhere along this path. I know it's the first day of school for my kids, but they're just gonna miss the first day of school. This is more important. This will be more of a life-changing experience than one day of school. I don't know when Millsaps starts in August.
The 21st.
The 21st, Monday. So make that a school holiday, or attendance optional. Attendance optional. Students will not get dropped from the class if they don't attend that first day because they're busy getting themselves over and coming back from the path of totality. Very good, Robert. Thank you. Thank you. You know. But if you're a professor doing last-minute preparations, which is the way I'm always doing it, well, first of all, shame on you. Second of all, do your preparations while someone else is driving or fly there or something like that. Don't miss it, because it's just, you know, I've had the privilege of being invited on many trips to exotic places as the astronomer on board, the lecturer. I give lectures on the expanding universe, how to observe the eclipse safely and all that. On a professor's salary, I could not do these extravagant trips, all right, to Malaysia or Mongolia or whatever. But this is one that nearly everyone can do, you know, so. All right, good luck. Well now, the expanding universe, or subtitled Dark Energy and the Runaway Universe. So this talk is about a subset of astronomy known as cosmology. Cosmology deals with the structure and evolution of the universe as a whole. We're interested in some of the grandest questions. Is the universe finite or infinite? What is its overall shape? What is its age? Is it infinitely old? Is it finite? When did the universe begin, basically? This was a big time story. See that? A big time story. Now, what will the fate of the universe be? Will it expand forever? Will it recollapse? Another big time story, you say. And this was actually about our group's work, and back then we thought we knew how the universe will end. Well now, 16 years later, we've done a bit more research, or we're not quite sure how it will end. But still, we're interested in the fate of the universe. That's what cosmologists want to know. We also want to know about the building blocks of the universe, the galaxies, which are these giant collections of tens to hundreds of billions of stars, gravitationally bound together. We live in a galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. This is not our Milky Way galaxy. If anyone has a photo of the Milky Way galaxy from this perspective, see me afterwards. I want to purchase usage rights. Obviously, we're like the mouse in the maze. You know, it's hard to get out of the maze. But anyway, the universe is filled with such structures. Here's one of my favorite photographs from the Hubble Space Telescope. A tiny but representative part of the sky. Take a grain of sand, hold it at arm's length. Imagine how small that looks. Well, that's the patch of sky photographed here. A tiny grain of sand in the sky, and yet, in this picture, there are thousands of galaxies. I could count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I could use up my remaining time counting galaxies. That would be pretty boring for you, but you know, it's a rather cushy job. They pay us to sit around and count galaxies. It doesn't get much better than that, folks. Anyway, we've taken a number of such photographs, and we can tell that statistically they're all the same. So extrapolated over the whole sky, there's something like 100 billion galaxies. And that's just in the parts of the universe that we can see. We now have good reasons to believe that the universe extends far, far beyond the parts that we can see. And everywhere it is filled with galaxies, the basic building blocks. So how did they form? How do they evolve with time? These two are among the central questions of cosmology. And so I feel so incredibly privileged to have been able to work in this field for several decades, contemplating and trying to answer these kinds of questions. A magnificent field. Now, before I move on, let me point out that among the lay public, present company excluded, because you're well educated and you came to this presentation, you could be playing tiddlywinks or whatever, be on Facebook, I don't know. But among the general public, there's considerable confusion between cosmology, the study of the structure and evolution of the universe as a whole, and cosmetology, the study of hairdos and facials. I admit, they sound similar. They have a common root, all that there is, or to make whole of. But as have astronomy and astrology, they have bifurcated, and they no longer represent the same thing. They're not even spelled the same way. Cosmetology is cosmology with an extra ET in it, like the extraterrestrial. I don't know the cosmic significance of that, but look, that's the only way in which cosmology and cosmetology have a different spelling. Well, you might say, surely I'm joking, you know, there isn't this confusion between cosmology and cosmetology. Well, I'm a scientist, so I want to give you evidence of this confusion. Here is an ad that a colleague of mine placed in my mailbox some time ago. Make cosmology your career. Training and supervision and hairstyling, blow drying, permanent waves, coloring and frosting, scalp treatments. You guys laugh, but these are very important topics, okay? Body and skin care, style cuts, basic cuts. For further information and interviews, call that number. Now, classes started back in March, so you missed that quarter or semester. But if you want to do as I and my colleagues have done and get to the cutting edge of this field, I know, I'm sorry. Puns are a highly underappreciated form of humor, but I like them. Anyway, if you want to get to the cutting edge of this field, then you need to take a course of this sort at your local college. Maybe it's even offered here at Millsaps. Okay, there we go. All right, shadow. By the way, very appropriate name for the eclipse coming up. Anyway, these people clearly need a lesson not only on their own profession, but a lesson in spelling and proofreading, because in addition to further here, you see hair spline, and coloring. Well, that's the British spelling, and my own thesis advisor was British, so I'll allow that one. But these guys don't even know their own profession. Actually, my father-in-law says, you know, Alex, the only real difference between your Berkeley course on cosmology and a course on cosmetology is that you don't give makeup exams. So he, too, is fond of puns. So I like my father-in-law. Anyway, so a central figure in this field was Edwin Hubble, after whom the Hubble Space Telescope is named. And he looked at galaxies. He actually utilized data that other people had taken. Vesco Slipher in Arizona spread out the light from a galaxy into a rainbow, a spectrum, and that can teach you a lot of interesting things about the galaxy and the stars of which it's composed. But in particular, these dark lines here are caused by chemical elements in the relatively cool outer parts of stars, and they produce this imprint, which is like a fingerprint. You know, this is hydrogen, this is neutral sodium, this is singly ionized calcium. A spectroscopist is trained to analyze these spectra. And it turned out that the spectra of galaxies are shifted toward redder wavelengths, longer wavelengths of light, the redshift. And nearby galaxies had a pretty small redshift, and more distant galaxies, which tend to look smaller in the sky, have a bigger redshift. So there's a linear relationship between the speed with which something is moving away from us now and its distance. And that led to this expanding universe, Big Bang model, which in fact had been derived and proposed by the Belgian priest and astrophysicist Georges Lemaître in Belgium in 1927. But he did not have the linear relationship that Hubble came up with in support of his theory. Nevertheless, he knew about the recession of galaxies, and he showed that one of the solutions to Einstein's equations is a naturally expanding universe. So in my opinion, he's the father of the Big Bang theory, but does not get the credit that he deserves. Anyway, this redshift grows with distance. So objects like light bulbs in observatories are not expanding. We're held together by electromagnetic forces. But the empty space between galaxies expands, and light waves expand with that empty space. So initially short wavelength blue waves become longer wavelength red waves. So from our perspective here in the Milky Way galaxy, all the others are moving away, and at a given time, right now, the more distant ones are moving faster than the nearby ones. So this brilliant discovery of an expanding universe. But before I move on, let me pause, because there's something a bit curious about this diagram as I've drawn it. What's strange about it? Yeah, we're at the center. Now, why would that be? Are we really that important? Or is it that all the other galaxies don't like us? Is it something we said? Is it who we voted for? Do we smell? Are all these other galaxies lactose intolerant? Get it? Milky Way galaxy, lactose intolerant galaxies. Or when I tell my students at Cal about cosmology and I present this, I say, what's the problem? Are we from Stanford or something? With due apologies to those of you who might be Stanford alumni or have kids there or relatives, it's an outstanding institution, it really is. I tip my hat. It's just not quite as outstanding as Cal. Anyway, no, we don't think we're in any central position. In a uniformly expanding universe, you expect each of the galaxies to think it's at the center. So here's my one-dimensional hypothetical universe. The ping pong balls represent galaxies. They don't expand. The space between them, represented by the hose, does. So this orange galaxy sees all the others moving away. It thinks it's at the center. But so does the yellow one, so does the white one, whatever. And this thing either goes on infinitely or wraps around itself. I'm not trying to fool you with edges here or anything like that. So they all think they're at the center. Moreover, notice that the more distant galaxies have more rubber between us and them than do the nearby galaxies. And if every bit homogeneously expands, then the more distant galaxies will have moved away a greater distance in a given amount of time than a nearby galaxy. And so you naturally get Hubble's relationship that at a given time, speed is proportional to distance. So that's a uniformly expanding universe. If you don't like a one-dimensional universe, it works for three-dimensional universes as well. Here's a loaf of raisin bread. The raisins don't expand. The dough is filled with yeast. You let it sit around for an hour. Let's say it doubles in size. This raisin sees all the others moving away. It thinks it's at the center, but so do all the other raisins. They see the same thing. And again, the universe is either infinite or it wraps around itself. Moreover, this one started out at 5 centimeters. After an hour, it's at 10. Advanced mathematics tells you that 10 minus 5 is 5. Average speed, 5 centimeters per hour. This one started out at 10. After an hour, it's at 20. 20 minus 10, 10 centimeters per hour. Hubble's law, a uniformly expanding universe. No unique center, at least not in the dimensions that we can physically probe. There might be a unique center in other mathematically describable but physically inaccessible dimensions. We actually don't know, because we don't know whether the universe is infinite or finite. Well, what's expanding? I've mentioned this again, but it's worth reiterating, because a lot of people just glibly say, well, the universe is expanding, everything's expanding, we're expanding. Well, that's just because you ate too big a lunch or whatever, but you're held together by electromagnetic forces. The Earth is held together by gravitational forces. It's not expanding. Our solar system is held together by the gravitational force of the sun. It's not expanding. Our galaxy is not expanding. This is Andromeda, by the way. We might look at it tonight over at St. Joe. But it's not expanding because it's held together by gravity. Clusters of galaxies are not expanding. They're held together by gravity. Now we're out to a million light years, folks. You might say, what is this about everything is expanding? We're out at a million light years. So far, nothing is expanding. It's at greater distances. It's the distances between clusters of galaxies, say on the 10 million light year scale. That's where the universe space is expanding. So, you know, a cluster of galaxies here and there might be moving away, or an isolated galaxy there and there. All these things, by the way, are galaxies. The things with points are stars. Not that stars intrinsically have points, but the telescope optics is what does that. Anyway, that's what's expanding. So you extrapolate this expansion back in time. You know, expanding gases cool and thin out. Similarly, compressing gases, you know, heats them up. Any of you who have pumped up the air in a bicycle tire know that. So anyway, you extrapolate backward in time. The universe used to be denser and hotter. It began at some singular moment. We think 13.7, 13.8 billion years ago. We call it the Big Bang. Some people don't like that term for the birth of the universe, so other possibilities have been presented. Here's one of my favorites, Bertha D. Universe, okay? That hasn't taken hold quite as much as the Big Bang, which Fred Hoyle coined in the 1940s, 49, I think. As a joke, really, he didn't like the Big Bang theory. Well, anyway, the data, and that's a separate talk, but the data strongly favor a dense, hot, compressed origin of the universe 13.7 or so billion years ago. You know, it's been expanding ever since. We don't know its purpose. We don't know what produced the laws of physics that caused this to happen. Those are questions that are, in a sense, outside of the realm of science. Science deals with the universe as it is and trying to explain the observed phenomena and predict new phenomena and then quantitatively measure them and see if the predictions agree with the theoretical, see if the observations agree with the theoretical predictions, and that's how science is done. Well, anyway, we live in this expanding universe. With today's instruments, we can measure the current rate of expansion. It's some number, happens to be an interesting number, but it's not the focus of my discussion today. The focus of my discussion today is that that number, the expansion rate, should be changing. And this goes back even to the principles of Newton. He supposedly saw the apple fall from the tree and wondered whether whatever it is that's causing the apple to move toward Earth is related to, or perhaps even the same as, what causes the moon to be falling toward Earth. And it is, it's just that it has a perpendicular motion too, and so it never hits. But that's what produces an orbit, the downward motion toward Earth and a perpendicular motion. And he united the terrestrial and the celestial through his laws of motion, and in particular his law of universal gravitation. So it was an absolutely brilliant breakthrough. Well, just as I toss the apple up and the mutual gravitational attraction between an Earth and apple slows it down, in this case, stops it, brings it back. Well, if the universe is sufficiently dense, then all these galaxies pulling on all the other galaxies should be slowing down the expansion of the universe. And it's not just the visible matter that slows down the expansion. There's dark matter as well. It turns out that Fritz Zwicky of Caltech, my graduate institution, although he died shortly before I got there, he looked at clusters of galaxies. And he said, wow, these clusters of galaxies, the galaxies within them are moving around so quickly that the clusters would fly apart unless there's extra stuff that's not visible but holding them together. And he suggested that there might be dark matter, among other suggestions, but it was one of his ideas, all right? And at the time, he was not taken very seriously. This was in the early 1930s. In fact, he had many brilliant ideas that were not taken seriously, but he was one guy who was way ahead of his time. Perhaps he wasn't taken seriously, both because his ideas seemed so outrageous, but also because he was arrogant and abrasive and did not think highly of the intellectual capabilities of his colleagues at Caltech. Now, Caltech is a fairly brainy place, all right? And his colleagues did not like it that he didn't think highly of him, of them. Here, for all I know, he's showing you what he thinks of the typical brain size of his colleague. Now, I don't know that that's what he's thinking, but he might be. And he is on record as having referred to his colleagues as spherical bastards. Because, you know, they're bastards any way you look at them. Now, a sphere is the only structure that looks the same from all directions, right? A box does not, for example. Now, I'm not suggesting that you start calling your friends spherical bastards. You may quickly end up friendless. Nevertheless, that's how he was, and he's one of my heroes, not because he was a mean guy, but because he was so brilliant and was so ahead of his time. Now, the study of dark matter is the rage. The other big proponent was Vera Rubin, who just died on Christmas a month ago, actually. Brilliant astrophysicist who studied spiral galaxies in the 1970s and said, you know what? They're rotating so quickly that they would fly apart unless there were extra matter holding them together. So she, after decades, you know, reinvigorated this discussion of dark matter but largely, again, ignored until roughly two decades later. And in the 1990s, dark matter became, you know, the big rage, and now people are still studying it. We don't really know what it is. And in my opinion, Vera Rubin should have received the Nobel Prize for her work, but did not. It's inexplicable, and she is now no longer eligible. What is dark matter? We don't really know. The best working hypothesis is that it's WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles. These are little particles that hardly interact at all. They're flying through us all the time. They're left over from the Big Bang. It's a very attractive idea. The only problem is that these things have not yet been detected in laboratories. That's a minor difficulty. If it continues to be that way for another 20 or 30 years, I'll say, well, it's back to the drawing board. Maybe the dark matter is not WIMPs. Right now, it's still possible that it's WIMPs. We haven't detected it, but if you were in a big enough ballroom that's completely dark, and there's one chair somewhere, and you're wandering around, you might not have hit the chair yet. Okay, so the WIMPs are, they're hard to find. They don't interact. So it could be that we haven't found them yet. Anyway, if there's enough dark matter and visible matter to slow down the universe a lot, then it's a little bit like this apple, a big bang and then a big crunch, or you could say big bang, gnab, give, which is big bang backwards. So in that kind of a universe, you're lying on your back looking at the galaxies, they're looking fainter and progressively smaller with time, and you say, I live in a well-behaved universe, but then you notice something odd, and right around now you get a little bit nervous, and then it's, goodbye, cruel world, because this would be the fate some tens of billions of years in the future if the deceleration is as big as it could be. But it could also be that the density of the universe is not sufficient to halt and bring back the universe. That would be like an apple thrown at or greater than Earth's escape speed. It continues to slow down forever, but not enough to bring it back. Rockets launched at more than 11 kilometers per second are at or exceeding Earth's escape speed. So in that case, the universe would continue expanding forever, becoming ever colder, darker, more dilute, and ending in ice, in a sense, instead of an ending in fire like the gnab give. Well, cosmologists are intensely interested in the fate of the universe, just because. We can ask this question, and as human beings, we can attempt to answer it. We're the only animals we know of that has this ability to ask and answer questions and build machines with our opposable thumbs with which to study the universe. And so some segment of the population should do these kinds of studies. Secondly, this kind of stuff excites kids. Astronomy is the gateway science. They get interested in science. They then are more likely to pursue science and technology and go into, in most cases, fields that are more immediately useful to society. Engineering, applied physics, medical physics, computer science, things like that. But the bug that bites them is the stuff that we learn about the cosmos. And then finally, you never know what practical spin-offs there might be. And one of my favorite examples is that when the quantum physicists a century ago were studying physics, Schrodinger and Einstein and Bohr and Heisenberg, they had not the slightest practical application in mind. They weren't trying to build a better toaster. They wanted to understand fundamentally two questions, the nature of light and the stability of atoms, and other questions as well. But that led them down the path of quantum physics. Fast forward one century, you could not imagine life today without quantum physics. Lasers, all the nanotechnology, all the computers, the trillion transistors at the head of a pin and stuff. That's all, you know, quantum physics, folks, and it was done by pure researchers. So that's how I justify my existence, okay? So anyway, we want to know. So how do we know? Well, you can measure the speed of the apple at many different times and see whether it's slowing down a lot, in which case it will come back someday, or not slowing down very much, in which case it might keep going away forever. So in a similar way, if you measure the expansion history of the universe, you could predict the future. We've measured the current expansion rate. How might we look back into the past and measure what the expansion rate used to be? Anyone want to venture a guess? Yeah, distant galaxies, very good. What's your name?
Annette.
Annette says, basically, look at distant objects. Light travels not at an infinite speed, but a finite speed. So Annette is about 30 feet away from me. Light travels a foot per nanosecond. That's a useful fact to know and tell at the next cocktail party you attend, thus ensuring you will never again be invited to a cocktail party. Believe me, I have been not invited to many cocktail parties after. Anyway, so Annette may not even exist anymore. She does. I see her 30 billionths of a second later. All right, not as she is right now. We see the sun about 8 1/3 minutes after the light was emitted, not as it is now. Even the nearest stars are some tens or hundreds of light years away, so we're seeing farther back into the past. And if we look at galaxies that are 1 billion light years away, 4 billion light years away, 9 billion light years away, we're seeing them as they were 1, 4, 9 billion years ago. And encoded in the light, in the form of the redshift, is information about how much the universe has expanded during the time that the light was on its way. So the non-infinite speed of light gives us a movie of the history of the universe. To look back in time, we simply look far away, and we can trace the expansion history of the universe. But we need to know how far away we're looking. For nearby galaxies, it's not so difficult. You take a picture like this one, you see individual stars. Let's call that Pat, just for kicks, you know. Let's say we study Pat in detail and realize that it's just like Betelgeuse, the left shoulder of the great hunter Orion. Betelgeuse is a magnificent, powerful star. We know its distance, we know how bright it appears to be, so we can determine how powerful it really is. By looking at how bright Pat appears to be, we can then figure out Pat's distance and hence the distance of its galaxy. And if you think, well, maybe that's just one star, maybe you're wrong, then choose another one, Shadow, or someone else, Kenneth, you know. And if you get the same distance each time, then that improves your confidence in your technique. It's just like you determine the distance of an oncoming car at night. By having calibrated the headlights of a nearby car at 6 feet away, whoa, it looks bright, you then look at progressively dimmer headlights and you almost intuitively figure out the distance of the car. If you're not very good at doing this, you shouldn't be driving at night, okay? So cars, stars, it's the same deal. Unfortunately, for the galaxies that are billions of light years away, individual stars are too faint to see and they crowd together. Right? This little blob there may consist of 10 billion stars, but you know, it could have fooled me. It looks like one to me. So you can't see normal stars. But there is one type of star that can be seen from distances of billions of light years. Any takers?
Quasar.
Yeah, we can see them far away, but they're not standard enough, it turns out.
Black star.
Hmm?
Black star.
Which kind?
Black
star, black hole, no, that's the opposite. You can't see black holes very well at all, right? Unless there's gas swirling around them, but then it turns out there can be different amounts of gas swirling around them, so it's not standard enough the way a headlight is.
Supernova.
A supernova, who said that? Yeah, very good. Yeah, a supernova, an exploding star. Now here's one, before explosion, after explosion, these things become millions or even billions of normal suns in brightness. Here's one, I've sped up the process, it takes a couple of weeks to brighten, but at its most brilliant, right there, it's a couple of billion suns. It's equal to the central region of that galaxy. That's one star blowing up. If our sun were to do this, sunblock of 50 just wouldn't cut it, folks. You need sunblock or supernova block of a few billion to protect yourself. But don't worry, be happy, our sun is not going to end that way. But these supernovae, besides being useful cosmological yardsticks, they are of critical importance to our existence. And even if you don't remember any of the cosmology, here's a take-home message, that and the eclipse. Each and every one of you owes your existence to the fact that some stars like this explode. And that's because stars are busy producing energy through nuclear reactions. Our sun is fusing hydrogen into helium right now. Later, it will fuse helium to carbon and oxygen. But if all stars were like the sun and did not explode, then that carbon and oxygen would be forever locked up in the core of our sun, not made available for the formation of new stars, planets, and life. But some stars do blow up, and they expel those heavy elements and additional heavy elements that more massive stars produce, and the explosions themselves produce yet additional heavy elements, dispersing them into the cosmos like this. Chemically enriched gases that have the heavy elements that simply did not exist, at least not very much, when the star formed. And we know this is happening. We know it because we can measure supernova remnants like the Crab Nebula and see through a spectral analysis that these are chemically enriched gases. The carbon in your cells, the oxygen that you breathe, the calcium in your bones, the iron in your red blood cells were all generated by nuclear reactions in stars and expelled by supernovae of this kind. We know of no other way in which heavy elements naturally form in the universe. This is where we came from. This is what Carl Sagan meant when he used to say we are made of star stuff or stardust. You quite literally were blown out of a star, not in one piece, obviously, but the stuff of which you are made, okay? McAfee is asking me for a security update. No, I don't want it, not right now. Anyway, not while I'm giving a talk. All right, play from current slide, hopefully. There we go. Here's after 10,000 years, these gases expand even more. And then they mix with other gases and form gravitationally bound clouds that then begin to collapse. And because these clouds, like the Orion Nebula, are enriched in heavy elements, the stars in their central regions, in some cases, have dusty disks, and from those disks, rocky Earth-like planets can form. This is what our solar system did 4.5 billion years ago. This is the origin of Earth. And somehow, somewhere on Earth, we don't know how yet, life began. It evolved. I'm skipping a few steps here. And it ended up with sentient Homo sapiens, who can try to understand their origin and the origin of the chemical elements of which DNA consists. And there's some of my DNA. I have 4 children. Well, we first have to calibrate cosmology. So, you know, before I go back to cosmology, we are made of star stuff, okay? There's a quiz later on. We are made of star stuff. That's the only question. And then the other question, I lied, is where should you be and what should you be doing on August 21st, 2017? All right, so we need to calibrate the nearby supernovae, but they're, you know, few and far between. So I could be a really cruel advisor and have my students, each of them, look through a telescope at one and only one galaxy until they find a supernova. That would be decades later. Meanwhile, I will have gotten, you know, all this useful service out of them before letting them graduate. There are some crimes that are so egregious that even tenured professors can and should get fired, right? I could have my students looking at thousands of galaxies. That improves their odds, but that's cruel and unusual punishment as well. Students need to study, they need to sleep, and they need to party. And so, not necessarily in that order. Fortunately, with modern technology, we have a better technique. We attach our digital cameras to the eyepiece end of a telescope. We take photographs of thousands of galaxies, and then we simply look for arrows. And where there is an arrow, there is an exploding star. You see it happen once, twice, 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. By rigorous mathematical induction, I conclude that this procedure works every time. Kidding, of course, the arrows aren't out there. What we've done is we've developed an automated telescope at University of California's Lick Observatory, where students can get trained and stuff. I love this observatory. And this telescope takes photographs of thousands of galaxies each week, repeats the process. Most of the time, the galaxies don't look any different over the course of time, but sometimes you get this arrow. Actually, you get this dot here, and we stick in the arrow. That's a supernova candidate. Could be something else as well. I then have students with their superior eye-brain combinations examine the candidates, determine which ones are likely exploding stars worthy of further consideration. And these students get their hands dirty with research at a young age. They get so jazzed up by research. Again, they aren't necessarily going to become PhD astrophysicists, but they get really jazzed by research, and they're trained in statistical methods and computer programming and analysis and stuff like that. So I'm very proud of our group. For a decade, actually, we found more supernovae than all other teams in the world combined. There's now a few that are finding more than we are. Here's one of my students at our weekly group lunch. I like to say he's the cosmetologist of our group. But then I remember that I teach at Berkeley, which has a slightly different student population, say, than Millsaps. But in any case, I'm not saying that's good or bad. But yes, there's a student of mine from some years ago. All right, well, having found supernovae, we then pass their light through a prism produces spectrum, and it turns out, I'm running out of time, that they come in different forms. They're the type 1s and type 2s. Type 2s have hydrogen, type 1s don't. That's significant because hydrogen is the most abundant element of the universe. Turns out we're interested in the type 1s for cosmology, in particular the type 1as. They come from a type of a star known as a white dwarf. Our sun will eventually become a white dwarf, but it will not explode because the white dwarf can only explode if it steals material from a companion star, becomes sufficiently massive for it to become unstable, and then it explodes. But since our sun is a solitary star, when it becomes a white dwarf, it will remain that way, we think, essentially forever. So it explodes in about the same way, at the same mass. So these are what we call standard candles. They're all about the same. So we found a bunch of them, we and other people, in galaxies whose distances we know, because we've measured normal stars like Pat and Kenneth and others there. So we know the distance of this galaxy, we measure the supernova's brightness, that tells us the power of the nearby car headlight, so to speak. We then try to find these things in distant galaxies for two reasons. Measuring their brightness then tells us the distance and hence the look-back time of the galaxy, and measuring the spectrum tells us the redshift or the galaxy's recession speed. Okay, and those are the two things you need to know in order to study the history of the expansion of the universe. We look for these supernovae using telescopes primarily in the southern hemisphere that have wide-angle fields of view that can cover many thousands of galaxies in one swath, about the size of the full moon. Again, nearly every blob you see there is another galaxy, not another star in our own Milky Way galaxy. We digitally subtract earlier images from later images. You get usually a bunch of noise, that's okay. Any measurement process necessarily has noise associated with it. But here, cleverly placed in the middle of the square, is something that looks like it might be real. A Hubble picture of it a few weeks later confirms it, and it's marked with an arrow, so you know it's got to be a supernova. Well, you don't really know until you study it with a big telescope, collect the light, form a spectrum, study if it's a type 1A or not. And that was my main job on both of the teams that made the discovery. I'm a spectroscopist by training, I study supernovae, and as a member of the University of California, I have access to these fantastic instruments. There's Fred Chaffee, a former director of Keck, showing you the size of the mirror compared to a person. They're amazing, amazing devices. So here's a spectrum, brightness versus wavelength. Here's a nearby type 1A, here's a distant one, and you can see they look pretty similar. So when we get data like this, well, then I'm a very happy camper. And now you see the real reason we build observatories in Hawaii. The San Francisco Bay Area is too cold for swimming without a wetsuit. But there are good scientific reasons for building telescopes in Hawaii as well. Well, here's the punchline, folks. Here's several type 1A supernovae dutifully marked with arrows. And the punchline is they're faint. They're really, really faint. And you might say, well, they're in these pathetic, scrawny-looking galaxies. These are obviously very distant galaxies. You don't even see the galaxy here. You expect the supernovae to be faint. And that's true, but they're fainter than expected. The implied distances are bigger than expected. They're too big. Suppose the universe were 1 second old, and I measure the distance of the apple from my hand after 1 second. Well, it's some distance, fine, but the apple slowed down. Let's make the Earth's mass less. I'm sorry, I can't do that. I can throw the ball faster, the apple faster. That has the same desired effect. It gets farther in 1 second. Oops, notice I can't catch, which is why I was never a cheerleader. Anyway, gets to a greater distance. If I were to cut off Earth's gravity, Earth doesn't exist, forget about the sun, Jupiter, blah, blah, blah. Physics students know this. It's intuitively obvious. Not so to Aristotle, but he always thinking about things on tables where there's friction. But if there's no friction, the thing keeps on going at a constant speed. So in 1 second, it would get to an even greater distance. Do I lie? Shadow, I do not lie. Well, but that's the farthest you can get, right? You can't get to a greater distance under the influence of gravity or no gravity than the distance you get moving at a constant speed. Yet we measured the apples, the supernovae, the galaxies in which they're located, to be at a greater distance, implying that it's like there's a rocket attached to the apple and it goes shoop, it speeds up and gets to a greater distance. Now you might say, well, my conclusion depended on the universe being 1 second old. What if it's 2 seconds old, right? What if the assumption of the age was wrong? Then it would get to a greater distance. If you were thinking that, good job. But it turns out the detailed arguments are independent of the assumed age of the universe. The galaxies were measured to be too far away given the expectation from their redshift. But that's the technical details. Just tell your neighbors the apples were too far away. Okay, anyway, in February of 98, I was privileged to announce this result to the world for the first time, representing one of the teams. We actually beat the other team, though they deny it. Anyway, astronomers see a cosmic anti-gravity force at work. We use this term hesitantly, anti-gravity, because people ask us, can we attach this stuff, whatever it is, to our cars and levitate over traffic jams? And the answer is no. This stuff is either a property of space itself, or if it's a substance and energy within space, there's so little of it that you can't harness it. By the end of the year, the editors of Science magazine proclaimed this discovery to be the single most important discovery in all areas of science that year. We were proud of that. The caricature of Einstein looks surprised here, not because he's blowing multiple universes out of his pipe. You may not have known that there are multiple universes and they come from the pipes of theoretical physicists. Well, the first part of that statement may well be true. The second part is probably not true. But he's surprised because this one universe is expanding faster and faster with time, whereas you would have expected it to be decelerating. He's doubly surprised because he has a sheaf of papers here where there's an equation, the Greek letter lambda equals 8 pi g, Newton's constant, times the density of the vacuum. You might say, what is this bozo from Berserkly saying, the density of the vacuum? You were taught on your mother's knee that the vacuum is sheer nothingness, emptiness. How can it have a non-zero density? Well, I'm just the messenger here. This was Einstein's idea. In 1917, physicists thought the universe is static. Hubble had not yet discovered the expansion. Lamette and Friedman had not yet predicted the expansion through Einstein's equations. It was thought to be static, and yet galaxies should be pulling on each other, so the sky should be falling in on us. It's not. So Einstein invented something he called the cosmological constant that went in the opposite direction, but with an exactly equal magnitude. So it's like the apple. Yes, gravity pulls down on it, but if I'm pulling up on it with exactly the same but opposite force, there will be no acceleration. You know, may the force be with you. There's the new Star Wars episode. No. May the net force be with you, right? The force may be with you, but if some other force is against you, you're going to lose. So Lucas needed to take freshman physics again. Please don't put this online. I don't want him to ask for funding from him or something. I don't want to make it sound. I know he had to say this. See, now I'm backpedaling. He had to say this in order to, you know, attract the masses, because if he got into technical terms like, may the net force be with you, then no one would have gone to the movies, you know. So, okay. Well, Einstein predicted this. He then renounced the idea. Okay, 12 years later, when Hubble discovered the expansion, because there was no need then for some arbitrary constant that implied that the universe has a non-zero energy density, which, by the way, is repulsive and for which there is no experimental laboratory evidence. He never liked this, and he said that it was the biggest blunder of his career, and here he is, sad that he ever introduced the idea. Well, what have we done? We've reincarnated it, not to make a static universe, but one which over distances of millions of light years is accelerating. So in this room, the down arrow dominates. In our solar system, down. In our galaxy, down. In our local group of galaxies, down. But as you get to 5 or 10 million light years and beyond, the up arrow dominates and you get an accelerating universe. And Einstein's biggest blunder, the concept of an anti-gravity like this, may indeed have been his greatest triumph. If he were around right now, his reaction might be something like on the cover of Science magazine. But is what we are seeing really the cosmological constant? We don't know. The cosmological constant would be a property of space. An alternative that many physicists find more palatable is that this is a new type of energy permeating space. It's not a property of space. Just like this light permeates the room, but it is not a property of the vacuum of the room itself. There's a subtle difference, all right? More generally, we call it dark energy. It's not the visible matter, because that's all gravitationally attractive. It's not the dark matter that Fritz Zwicky and Vera Rubin proposed, because that's gravitationally attractive. It's dark energy, which is repulsive. And this made clear now our conversation in the car, Pat. It's a repulsive energy, all right? And now we know that roughly 70% of the matter plus energy content of the universe, you have to add the two together because of E equals mc squared, it's this dark energy. Again, not in this room, not in the US, not in our solar system, but averaged over billions of light years, this is what the universe is made of, and we don't know what it is. Maybe the youngsters here will figure it out. 25% is dark matter, back from the days of Zwicky and Rubin. We don't know what that is. 5% is normal matter, of which only 0.5% is easily observable normal matter. So in a sense, we're the debris of the universe, the afterthought of creation. Not to say we're not important. You are to yourselves, your loved ones, your family, your friends, but you're not the dominant stuff of the universe. The dominant stuff is the dark energy followed by the dark matter. So that's pretty amazing. The dark energy causes an accelerating expansion of the universe. It'll keep on going faster and faster. That's pretty amazing. Physical origin is a huge mystery. This, many physicists think, is the most important observationally motivated unsolved problem in all of physics. 70% of the universe, we better explain it, it's the majority of the universe. And it perhaps provides clues to a unification of the two great theories of modern physics, quantum physics of the very small and general relativity of the very large. Because we think that whatever this stuff is, it's a quantum process, but it occurs everywhere. So because of its importance and because it was verified in many ways in the 13 years ago, the 13 years following 1998, in 2011, it was honored with the Nobel Prize in Physics, and the specific people who won it were the two group leaders, Saul Perlmutter and Brian Schmidt, and my postdoctoral scholar as a member of Schmidt's team, the one whose work in the mid to late 1990s I personally supervised at Berkeley. So I'm glad he was chosen as the third person as well. These gentlemen understood that without the rest of us working in the trenches, the discovery would not have been made and they would not have been honored in this way. So they spent part of their $1.5 million flying the rest of us out to participate in Nobel Week. And we got to go to all the parties. The only thing we didn't do is get to shake the hand of the King of Sweden, get a gold medal, and a share of the $1.5 million. But that's the way it goes. That's no small change for an academic. Okay, so for anyone in that matter. There's the other team. I'm not in that picture because right at that moment, the main team of which I was a member was having its celebratory lunch, at which my wife, Noelle, came up with and distributed the consolation prize for all those of us who were not technically awarded the Nobel Prize. It is a limited edition t-shirt. Dark energy is the new black. Yes. Nice. And then just a year or two ago, the breakthrough prize people, a new type of prize, honored actually all team members specifically because they understand that nowadays, not in the days of Alfred Nobel a century ago, but nowadays science is done largely by teams and stuff, so they honored all of us. That was nice. So how will the universe end? Well, if this dark energy remains repulsive, then the universe will expand faster and faster and faster with time. A runaway universe. Okay, it's this thing that goes off like this. It might even get stronger, in which case the universe expands even faster. If that's the case, and if you want to see galaxies like this one with your very own eyes through a telescope, then come out to the James Observatory here at Millsaps College and look at a galaxy before it's too late. By that I mean in the next few tens of billions of years, okay? Because in that amount of time, all the other galaxies will have been whisked away to distances that we cannot see. But it's possible that the sign of the dark energy will change. And if I just go back here, it's conceivable that we live here right now, that it'll keep on expanding for a while, and then maybe the dark energy will become gravitationally attractive, in which case we could still end with the big crunch. And that's something we realize now, which we did not fully realize in 2001. So the universe may still end in fire. My odds are with ice. Robert Frost could not have known of these two possibilities in 1923 when he wrote his famous poem, Fire and Ice, but it's very appropriate given the subject matter. Some say the world will end in fire. Some say in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. But if it had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction is also great and would suffice. So Frost would prefer a passionate, hot universe that collapses in on itself. But if the universe and he had to perish twice, then eternal expansion ending in ice is okay with him, and that's perhaps appropriate given his name, Robert Frost. Thank you very much. I hope there's time for a few questions. I know there's another thing here going on, but maybe. How much time do we have? A few minutes? Yes, so and I'll repeat the questions for the benefit of everyone.
I would take maybe one or two questions.
Okay, and then as I'm putting the equipment away, you can ask some more. So anyway, I'll repeat the question for anyone. Yes, back there, yes. Hi, Scott. Yeah, good to see you.
What is the observational data saying now about the Big Rip?
Oh, the observational data, Scott asks, what does it say now about the Big Rip? The Big Rip is where the dark energy gets stronger and stronger with time per unit volume. Now that's admittedly very strange, but it's not, you know, impossible. It does violate certain things that we think are laws of physics, but they're not as unviolatable as certain things that we think are laws. We don't really know what the laws are, right? So the data are consistent with the Big Rip, but probably it's just constant dark energy. That's the more palatable solution. But the data are not inconsistent, let me put it that way, with their Big Rip. And if that's the case, then someday the dark energy will cause clusters of galaxies to fly apart, and then galaxies will get ripped apart, and then planetary systems will get ripped apart, and then planets, then humans, and then the very atoms of which we consist. The Big Rip. You call it the Big Rip-Off, I guess, but like I say, it's not excluded by the data, but most of us do not favor that solution right now because it appears to violate certain things that we think we know. But, you know, you never know whether what you think is now is correct, right? Science is that way, right? We're open to surprises. We're open to changing our minds. Yeah. So that's the process.
All right, maybe one more question?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah, yes.
What drove you towards this type of research?
Yeah. So it was really this fundamental desire. Do you mean the measuring the expansion or astrophysics in general?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So good. It's like, would you like coffee or tea? Yes. Generally speaking, I'm in love with science because it gives us a systematic, quantitative way to understand the workings of the universe. Not its purpose, not your purpose, not my purpose, not how we should conduct ourselves, but the mechanical workings of the universe are described by science. And you can see the effects of that through technology, where we apply science. It's been remarkably successful. And so I just found it such an amazing thing to be able to learn about others, what others are doing, and then to try to contribute in some way. And it's delusions of grandeur, which only some of us have, if you think you're going to make a revolutionary discovery. I only hope to make a small contribution, and I was just darn lucky in being at the right place at the right time to contribute to one so revolutionary. And then specifically this project, you know, what could be one of the grander, one of the grandest questions is the fate of the universe, right? We're interested in the fate and the origin of nearly everything, right? And so the fate of the universe, what an amazing question. Something that just begs for an answer, and I don't know that we'll ever know definitively, because we'd have to measure the properties of the dark energy with infinite precision to rule out all possible hypotheses. In science, we never know the truth with an uppercase T, the reality with a big R, right? Science, and in particular physics, is simply a progressively better approximation or description that fits the results of experiments that have been done and makes predictions for the results of experiments and observations yet to be done. And to the degree that the predictions match the results, you pat yourself on the back and you say, great, our theory is doing fine. But you never know whether that's reality, you know. But still, the fact that we've gone in this progression, say, from
Newtonian physics, which works remarkably well under most circumstances, to Einstein's special relativity, which works better when things move fast, to Einstein's general theory of relativity, which works better when things are massive. And then on the other end, quantum physics, which is the physics of the very small, and is utterly non-Newtonian. Right? Those are the two ends. They work beautifully. But when you ask about the quantum vacuum, for example, you get nonsense bringing these theories together. Or the singularity in the middle of a black hole, you get nonsense. So the holy grail in theoretical physics right now is a quantum theory of gravity, one that unites the very small and the very massive. We're not there yet. String theory is a candidate. It's the one that has the most public attention right now and the most physicists working. If we do get it someday, will that be the end? No, because there could someday be an observation that is not explained by that quantum theory of gravity, which means there will be yet more for us to explore. And finally, of course, why is there anything? Why are there any laws of physics? That's a very personal thing. Science can't answer that question, I think. So on that note, let me end. Thank you very much.